marriage and chakras. I had spoken yesterday on certain aspects. Number one, can a dualistic person be enlightened? Enlightenment happens only when all dualities vanish. You are beyond all dualities of the body, mind, intellect. You know that everyone, everything sentient or insentient is shining in the glory, the light, the noor. But then afterwards, after one gets enlightened, he has to live in the world. Deep down he knows that there is no difference between you and I. You carry the same light that I carry or that the Sheikh carries. But for the sake of growth, for the purpose of transformation, we have to remember that we are two different individuals living in two different circumstances and situations. You have not yet attained the harmony within. Then you can call that there is a dualistic approach. When I am talking to you, there are two persons, one is talking and the other is listening. But this is not called duality. This is of a different nature. This is the way of operation. And when we talk enlightenment and duality, that is because enlightenment is an individual process. You are the one who has to experience first the oneness within, then the state beyond duality, and in that enlightenment happens. But you can live in the world. I am talking to you in a way there is a duality. These energy fields, tawajjo, chakra, and all that is esoteric, which cannot be seen, it can only be experienced. It is for experience, not for knowledge. When a sheikh, you are sitting in a congregation in Maraqba, tawajjo flows, there is no knowledge that can make you understand what tawajjo is. Words cannot explain. Tawajjo means the flow of energy. It is attention. The master allows his energy to fill. But this is for experience. So you have to keep your mind completely clean of all knowledge so that you do not expect anything. And when you experience something, you are ready to accept it. It happens exactly like this. There are seven widely known centers, but they never exist in the same place for all the people, because individual is a living organism. It is not like the furniture in your house that remains fixed without moving. Your two people are sitting in a congregation, their thought process will be different. So it can never be the same. And there are experiences, but never happen in the same way for two persons. In reality, they happen very differently. So there is no need to know the physiology of Kundalini or these centers. There is no need to know chakras. Also, there is no need to know what happens finally. If you know it, you will start hypnotizing yourself. And by, you will start getting into the ritual. You will create a kind of dream around you. And when there are many people doing the same thing, you tend to fall into crowd mentality. And then you start swaying with the crowd. Once awareness has moved to the third eye center, because below that there is duality. The two centers work together. I was mentioning to you the solar plexus represents the solar energy. Solar energy has malefic effects and beneficial effects. You have to filter the this we know when we look at the sun, the malefic and the beneficial effects. In the same way, when this energy comes within you, the malefic effect is nafs, desires. It comes because of unfulfilled desires. And the beneficial effect is when you are freed of desires, freed of lust, freed of anger, a different kind of beneficial energy comes in that has capability first to transform you, and then through your energy it brings transformation in others as well. In the same way, the heart energy is also guided by a deity that has two effects. One is the cooling effect, which is represented by Parvati or the consort of Shiva. The other is another consort of Shiva, which is known as Devi. Through this, Shiva explained 112 techniques of meditation. It is nearly 5,000 year old treatise. Vigyan means science. Bhairav means that which is beyond all that is known. Tantra, the art of knowing the esoteric. Through Devi, she asks the questions. The treatise begins. Devi is sitting on the lap of Shiva, with her head bent in a loving gesture. She looks towards the face of Shiva and she asks question, "What is thy reality, O Shiva? What is thy reality? What is this wonderful universe?" And in response to each question, Shiva gives a technique. Most of these techniques are breath oriented, and through that he could have given a philosophic answer. He does not. He simply gives a technique, and through that technique, when you follow that, you will come to know the answer. The question that is arising in your mind will dissolve. This is the way the masters appear. So from that we decipher the role of a female being, or the feminine aspect of your inner self. The esoteric life is that the female, or you can look at it consort, she has many roles to perform. She has to be loving, it is she who has to initiate the male into the esoteric aspects of Tantra. Why is all the masters emphasize, the Sufi masters, except those traditions, they are ascetic in nature. Let the poor dog do his sermon. He has also a tendency when he hears me carrying on my meditation session, he does his own. So it is the woman who initiates the man into Tantra. This is another aspect of the two aspects of male-female relation. And through that, not only the individual energies are balanced, but the two attain to inner balance and transcend beyond. This is the esoteric aspect of Islam, which is not highlighted. What was the role of Hazrat Khadija Rahmatullah Alayh Raziyallahu Ta'ala Unhu in the life of Holy Prophet? It was she who consolidated and who allowed all that happened, brought the understanding of all that happened, and she was the one who initiated Holy Prophet into Tantra. But this does not mean those who do not have the opportunity of getting married or male-female relation that they cannot journey along the spiritual path. For them, there is another method has to be used. Indian mystic, the 3rd century mystic Shankar, was a monk and he did not marry. Once he was in argument, that is called a debate, with one of the learned person of the time, Mandan, and it happened that he nearly defeated Mandan in debate, but then his wife came in front and said, Mandan is not defeated. Wife is said to be half because the completion happens half male, half female. So you have to enter into debate with me, and if you can defeat me in debate, only then Mandan is finally defeated. She asked him a question about marriage, male-female relation, of which Shankar was unaware. He sought time for 6 months, and then he gathered his disciples to sit around in a semicircle way to continue the meditative energy. And then he realized, he found that a king was dying. Through his yogic powers, he entered into that person, the king, lived there 6 months, experienced that, and he returned. So such kind of meditation is very delicate. So Buddha introduced a technique of meditation that is known as Jati Samran. You are carried into your past lives. Some of you would have had male-female relation in this life. I keep on emphasizing, you have to enter into that life meditatively. There would have been some moments of extreme joy, fulfillment, and then things became sour and relationship ended. You have to meditatively enter into that and relive those moments. Abraham Maslow, he spoke of going into the past lives, but he could not carry beyond the age of 6. Up to 6 years of age, he could carry through his techniques into the lives, but beyond that it was not possible. So this is possible only because of the technique of meditation that Buddha introduced. But this cannot be done on one's own. It requires the energy field of the one who knows you. So this is the heart center, the two energies. One is love, care, the family aspect. The other is the tantric aspect, the initiation into the esoteric science of love. These two roles can be performed by one individual, but the roles are separate. The techniques are separate. So it is shown differently by using the two concert, one as Parvati, the other as Devi. And thereafter, when the energy moves to the third eye center and it starts functioning and becomes alive, that is why Hindus call this as chakra. Once again here, it has two aspects. One is known as the throat, the energy of throat and the third eye work together. They work together because all that you experience, it has to be expressed through the vocal cord, through the throat center. There comes a tremendous desire once you experience something to share it with the people. But unless and until it becomes your own experience, your sharing can become a problem for you. This is represented by the Hindu god of Trinity, Shiva. He is scantily dressed with his skin around him. His neck is blue because once he drank the poison which could have destroyed. Now this is very symbolic. Sometimes you know something about the other person. If you say something, it can destroy his or her life, her relation. So you keep it secret within and do not allow. But if that information is released below the throat center, the poison that is in the throat center, it can store there. But if you release it, it will damage your entire bodily system and inner systems. It is something like this. I know one of your secrets and I go and tell your spouse, that will destroy your life. So I have to learn the art of keeping that secret within me. And because of that, the throat is shown symbolically as blue. The other is the third eye. When you transcend, you are not affected by anything. And it is from that center all the tawajjuh takes place. The master moves, allows his energy, just a thought alone, and energy begins to move from the heart center, which is the center of love, to the two eyes. Eyes are the source, the most important part of the body. It expresses you, it defines you. In the face, the most expressive part is the eyes. Eyes are the most expressive, and love moves through the eyes. It becomes an expression through gestures. It pronounces aesthetic beauties. And then it reaches to the third eye, because the two eyes are still duality. It reaches to the third eye, and from there the energy moves to the seeker. And wherever there is a lack of flow of energy or blockage, it goes and begins to work at that center. So for this, every center has to be relaxed first and the foremost. The earth center has to be relaxed. It can develop constipation as well as diarrhea. It has to function at its optimum 100%. Only then energy starts moving. Energy is needed. And energy is always beautiful. If you do not know how to use it, it becomes ugly and it goes on running astray. The energy has to go higher. Sex is the lowest center of your being. But that is not all. You have seven centers of your being. As energy moves upward, if you know the key how to release it upwards, as it moves from one center to another, you feel many stages of transformation. Sufis call it different states or mukamat. When energy comes to the heart center, you are full of so much full of love that for the first time you become embodiment of love. You feel like dancing, frisking. You can share everything that you have. There is a particular incident in the life of Buddha. Buddha always sat with one leg folded and other hanging, with his eyes half closed, half open in meditation. This is symbolic. When your eyes are completely closed, you can fall asleep. And when your eyes are completely open, you are not meditative. When your eyes are half closed, half open, then you are neither asleep nor you are on the borderline. So what happened? His disciple Purn came and he said, "Master, with your grace, whatever has happened to me, I feel like flying like a bird, sharing all that you have poured into me, pour love onto the person." Buddha kept his eyes half open, half closed. He said, "If in that process, when you are going to share your love with the people, they do not understand you and they abuse you, what would you do? What would you do?" Introspect on that. Purn said, "What would abuse do to me? They are simply words. They do not reach my inner being. If somebody says, you are so and so, thank you very much. But that is your interpretation. Or even that is not necessary to say. Just thank, or even not thanking, just quietly accept it. But Poon said, what will abuse do? They cannot even reach my inner being. Buddha said, if those people are not satisfied with that even, and they curse you, he said, that too will not do anything to me. He said, if they pelt stones at you, he said, stones can inflict wounds only on my body, but not the inner being. But what happens? Even when someone says some words which are not pleasing to you, what is your reaction? And here Purn says, Buddha, when he asked, if those people pelt a stone at you, what would you say? Purn replied, the stones can only hurt my outer body. It cannot inflict wound on my inner state, which is my own experience. I have experienced something within that is not a fake thing. It cannot be disturbed by these ordinary means. Buddha said, if they are not satisfied with pelting stones as well and they kill you, Poon said, sir, if along your path I am killed, I know they cannot kill me because I am not the body. I am not the mind. The body is killed. It is destroyed. And I will feel myself privileged that along the path spreading the message of peace, I have sacrificed at the altar. Buddha opened his eyes. He said, now you have. You can go and share. And unless you have, you cannot share. And what you have has to be the experience of love within. The energy has reached the heart center. It begins to overflow. You can be like the bird flying, soaring high in the sky. Doesn't make any effort, it simply lays its wings stretched and floats. Then the energy comes to the heart center. No, from the heart center it moves and reaches the third eye center. That is the center from where the instructions are given. Someone has to be in an organization who gives the authority for different departments to function. If that authority is not there functioning, there will be a complete chaos. Everyone is assigned their duties and there is someone who is there to see that everyone performs their duty properly. And if someone or a particular department is not fulfilling its duty properly, he calls the person and gives instruction and explains the things to that person. Up to here there is duality. The earth center and water center are together. The solar plexus and the heart center are interconnected with one another. When the malefic effects of sun in the form of sun energy, in the form of ego, desire, all these vanish, you are in the beneficial effects of the sun energy, solar energy. When this energy comes from outside, just as when you were In mother's womb, you were connected to her through the umbilical cord and you were getting your nourishment from there without any effort. So when you reach to that state, you are connected to the cosmic womb and you are getting the nourishment through an infinite source. When a master says, look at how much he sleeps, how much he eats, and his energy level is much higher than yours. It is said, when someone asks a Sufi mystic, who was a French lady and who was associated with Sri Aurobindo and lived in Pondicherry in his ashram, she said, do you think the energy that I have, it comes from the frugal meals that I eat? Energy comes from inner balance, inner harmony. Then you are not dependent so much on the outer food, because you are directly connected through the umbilical cord to the sun energy, and sun is the source of energy. With sun rising, sun coming on the forefront, everything becomes alive. It is because of the sun and the moon energy that the fruits ripe. It is because of the balance of sun and the moon energy that flowers blossom. It is because of this sun and the moon energy that your inner self begins to blossom. All these are duality. The sun energy and the heart center, they work together. Then the throat center, which is the fifth, and the sixth is the third eye, they work together. They harmonize one another. And when the first two centers, the earth and the water center, merge into one another, your physical level of energy is balanced. In case of male-female relation, the physical aspect of male-female relation or marriage is fulfilled. Then that is not all. And through initiation into Tantra that the woman does, you understand the second layer of your energy, which is emotional. You can understand this with another example. You have returned from your office tired. You tell your spouse, your children, that I am very tired, I am going to take a rest. All of a sudden, something happens. Maybe there is an electrical shortage, or you get a phone call that you have won something, or a long lost friend comes in. You jump out of the bed, you get a different kind of energy in you. Where does that energy comes into you? This is the emotional layer of energy. And you can work tirelessly. And then comes the third layer of energy, which is a spiritual energy, when you are connected to the cosmic womb. Or you become oceanic. The ocean or the existent lets its total energy and pours it into you. You are the reservoir of energy. And it happened. These are the three doors. It is like you are entering into a building. You are coming from outside. The first door you have to cross, this is the door leading to the physical energy. When you have crossed that door, then you can enter the second door, which leads you to the emotional energy. And when you reach to the third door, you enter into, you cross that door, you enter into the last door beyond which there is nothing. This is the ultimate. It is something like another example. You begin to court with your spouse. First time you meet outside in somewhere, wherever it may be. And if your spouse happened to visit your house, you entertain your spouse by the gate. And then one day you may allow, open the gate and allow him to come and meet in the living room. Still it is the second, you have opened the first door, you have entered. Then as the relationship becomes more and more intense, you are allowed to meet alone. Then one day your spouse can enter your bedroom, which is the innermost part of your existence. These are the three stages or three doors. You can practice this by using a simple exercise, how to open the doors of three layers of energy. A very simple exercise that will help you start jogging. When you start jogging, a point comes when you feel tired, or your instructor says you have to continue to jog more. You say that I will fall down, I cannot jog anymore. He says no, you have to continue to jog. There is a psychological fear that you have reached the level, the threshold of the level of energy, and it will disappear any moment and you will fall down. But if you gather courage at that moment, you can continue for another 15 minutes uninterruptedly without falling or dropping, and you will be surprised at how I didn't drop, I just continued. This is known as threshold in exercise. You have entered the second layer of energy. And then when you continue, you can continue for another 15-20 minutes, then again a point comes when you realize that you cannot go anymore. Pause for a moment. No, I have to continue for another 15 minutes because I have decided to jog for 30 minutes or 60 minutes. Then you have opened the third layer of energy. And then you will realize that you can enter into these different layers of energy on your own free will. The first example that I gave you in news that came to you that something happened, this is because of circumstance or situation that you have been able to transcend the physical energy and reach the second layer of energy, emotional, and the third layer of energy. But here you are consciously making an effort, and when you succeed, then it happens. You are tired. On a day-to-day basis, I am living in the world, doing all the activities that are necessary for my living. Tiredness comes in when you are continuing to do the physical work. Yesterday morning, after the meditation session was over, I had some goods to be brought from the warehouse to the showroom area. So I had told the person to bring it after 7, and it was heavy and the light big, or all different size, 20 cartons. They have to be placed in the right place wherever they have to be. It's a tiring work. Naturally, you get tired. But it took me less than a minute. I came, sat down, just introspect within. I entered into the second layer of energy. This can happen on you. Yes, give me a minute. And you would have noticed that during the time when you are with the Sheikh, how hectic his schedules are. And what is his level of energy? Have you ever introspected? You get tired and you have to go rest, go and take a rest. But Sheikh Hisham, he works tirelessly. He is older than you. Where does his energy come from? He has been able to tap that reservoir of energy within him, that he is connected to the cosmic energy and at his will he can reach there. Just introspect his functioning, his day. You would have seen him on a day-to-day basis, that how does he work. Everyone wants to meet him. He has to accept that, and yet still he is not showing any sign of tiredness, because at his will he can enter into different layers of energy. This happens when you have transcended the physical energy, emotional energy and spiritual energy. And as I mentioned, you can do this exercise to change the threshold. I still do the different exercises. When I finish 100, I realize that I cannot go anymore. No, I have to do one more. Another 100. Yes, I have to do another 100. After 200, another? Oh no. No. That is not so. What I have to do another 100, because I had decided initially to do 300. 300 push-up. And after 300, you feel as fresh as you was before doing that, or sometimes even more. And you will feel that there is no tiredness. You increase. That is what the word is used, pain threshold. Your level of pain threshold keeps on changing. The body sitting down in a particular posture gets to feel pain. I am sitting down, you are sitting down in meditation for almost 3/4 of an hour. Because of that intense talk, maybe you may say the talk is interesting, that's why I did not change my posture. But where my fingers were, it is the same place, it has not moved. Because there is no need to move my fingers or feet or anything else. That is where willingly, on your own free will, you can move to different layers of energy. When the energy reaches the last center, which is on top of the head or the crown chakra, which is the center of bliss, you are in a state of bliss. The season of spring has arrived. Your tree of life has come to a fulfillment. You become a Buddha, the enlightened one. But the energy is the same. Therefore, do not condemn or suppress anything. If the energy expresses itself at the base center, it is not to be condemned. The water that flows into different taps in your house is the same. It's a constitution, it's a chemical formula, is the same. But when it flows from the bathroom tap, it is called the water from the bathroom. But that does not change. Yes, it may happen if the place is contaminated, but the water that is coming is not contaminated, it has the same composition, H2O, two molecules of hydrogen and one molecule of oxygen. But because of the surroundings where it is overflowing, it may have the contamination. So when the same energy moves from the earth center or the water center, or you can say the combination of sex centers, because of your lust, because of your unfulfilled desires, the energy gets contaminated. But if the desires are no more, if unfulfillment is no more, then the same sex energy becomes purified. Even at that center, it becomes purified. So it is the energy that remains the same, so there is no need to condemn or suppress it. The existential energy is to be transformed, be more understanding, alert. Only then you will be able to enter the totality. Each chakra has its own color. So when you concentrate on a particular center, you have certain colors in your dreams and visions. As you move upward, the color changes. In fact, in yoga psychology, a person's dreams, fantasies and visions can indicate where his energy is exactly. So when you mention of your dreams and the colors, the master knows. He may not say something, but he begins to work. Sometimes you are deluded by the body, and somehow if you manage to go beyond the body, you are deluded by the mind, which is even deeper than anything else. The first three centers, the earth, water and the fire, the solar plexus, belong to the body. The next three centers belong to the mind, because the love, the expression, all these belong to the mind. But it is not nafs, it has moved to suluk. The first three chakras belong to the body, the next three belongs to the mind, and the seventh is beyond both body and mind. Ordinarily, the people who indulge remain in the first three lower centers. They hang there, and those centers are earth center, water. In yoga terminology, these are known as Muladhara, Swadhisthana and Manipur, the earth, water and the fire centers. These are earthly centers. They are attracted by the gravitational force, thus they are pulled downwards. The next three centers, the heart center, the throat center and the third eye center, are skybound. Gravitation does not affect them. They are under another law called levitation or grace. So sometimes in meditation you begin to feel levitated. They are pulled upwards. These three consist of mind. The body is pulled downward, mind is pulled upwards. But you are neither. You are neither the body nor the mind. You are the transcendence, and the transcendence is represented by the seventh, which is neither body nor mind. So the people who indulge life in the first three centers, and the people who repress the first three centers, start living in the next three chakras, but they create a dreamlike world. The center around which One's life has revolved is the center from where he will depart in his life. The place where he dwelt the whole life will be the place from where his life will come to an end. Therefore, a yogi can live from the third eye center, and a lover lives from the heart center. The life energy of the enlightened one would live from the seventh or the crown chakra, his skull. It is said when energy releases from there, there is a very soft spot in the head, and from there when it is released, it makes a hole. In certain monasteries in Tibet, they have kept these skulls where there is a hole. That's the point from where the energy has released. Where the energy has departed from. It happened in the life of Lalaji Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu or Ramchandra. It happened that he was suffering from some stomach ailment. So his master Abdul Sheikh Shah Abdul Ghani Khan Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu, Chacha Ji Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu, his son Mahatma Jagmohan Narayan Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu, Brijmohan Lal Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu, and his consort, these people were allowed in the room. A message was sent to a local doctor. So he said, when it is the last, who was against all through his life, he was against Lalaji. And the message was sent that the Sheikh is not feeling well, just come and visit him. He said, when the last time has come, then you are seeking the assistance of the doctor. When the message reached, Lalaji simply said, I am willing to leave this world without any problem. But he does not know whose time has come. Within half an hour to 45 minutes, the message comes that the person has passed away. When it was the last time, Lalaji continued to narrate that his life force is now leaving from the big toe. There is no more life there. It has crossed the calf, reached the knee. Below that, the body has no life. The life force has receded from there. Then he continued to narrate, and everyone was experiencing that. When he energy reached the heart center, he said, now it is crossing. The energy on its journey of transcendence is crossing the heart center. When it reached the throat center, he said, now it has reached the throat center, and beyond this I will not be able to explain anything to you. And then it happened. Everyone in the room experienced a glow of light came out of his forehead, of his top of the head, and dissolved into the room. There was tremendous light everyone experienced, and this is how he entered into the realm of the divine or alam-e-ghayb. A master, an enlightened one. It is a great benediction, because tremendous energy is released when a master leaves the body. It happened with Hazrat Amir Kalal Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu. His disciple Hazrat Shah Bahauddin Naqshband Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu married his Sheikh's daughter. And after Hazrat Amir Kalal Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu passed away, the relation between Hazrat Shah Bahauddin and his wife remained that of brother and sister, two people along the path. This happens when energy has transcended beyond the physical, then the relation between the male and female becomes that of fellow beings along the path. The two fellow beings. Sex becomes immaterial then. If it happens, nothing is wrong. If it does not happen, nothing is lost. You have transcended, you have experienced the state beyond sex. Then its presence or absence makes no difference in your life. You have attained fulfillment even without it. And Hazrat Amir Kalal, Hazrat Shah Bahauddin Naqshband RaziAllahu says that at a time when Hazrat Amir Kalal RaziAllahu passed away, left his life, both of them, Hazrat Shah Bahauddin and his wife, they experienced that angels were chanting Durood Sharif. And they surrounded the body of Hazrat Amir Kalal RaziAllahu, and it was the chanting in a loud voice, and both of them heard. And thereafter, the relation between Hazrat Shah Bahauddin and Hazrat and his wife became that of two along the same path. The life energy of the enlightened one would leap from the crown center, the seventh center in his skull, and break open as it departs from that particular center. This is the way the energy moves. When the energy moves upward, you become more and more silent. Silence is the byproduct of energy moving upward, and tension is the byproduct of energy moving downward. It is an indication when tension comes into you under any circumstance and situation, it symbolizes your energy is moving downward. You will be more and more in anxiety, full of anger when energy moves downwards. On the contrary, you will be more and more silent, quiet, calm and cool as the energy moves upward and inward. So yesterday when I had to do all that work, and this morning after the session is over, again two pallets will be brought, nearly about 30 cartoons which have to be arranged and put it into the place. There is a coolness. This has to be done. And this is what happens when you are walking around a sheikh. Everything is working within his energy field, and you feel that you are in a different kind of energy field. There is no tiredness. Instead, there is silence, there is calm, quiet, and everything takes place as if you are simply an instrument and it is the invisible hands that is doing the work. Whereas in your case, you are haphazard and you feel that you have to do this, you have to do that. No, it is something beyond that reminds you this has to be done now, that has to be done, and invisible hands do the work. And these words, downward and outward, are synonymous, and inward and upwards are synonymous as well. And when you have become silent, that energy is moving, is like a flood. It is passing through all the chakras, all the centers, and when it passes through these centers, it cleans them, purifies them, and make them dynamic, alive. And the flood goes upward, upward to the last center. Sex is the first center. And when you are living at that, you are living at its minimum. When the energy flows upward, and reaches to the last center, the energy is at its maximum. Life is at its maximum, and then you feel as if the whole cosmos has become silent. Nothing else, not even a single sound is there. That is what happens sometimes when you sit down in meditation. You become totally oblivious of the outside noise because the energy has reached to the thousand petal centers or the crown center. Everything becomes absolutely silent when energy comes to the last center. You know the first center, it will be easy to understand through that. When the energy comes to the sex center, you become absolutely tense. The whole body is feverish. Your every cell is in fever. Your temperature goes high, blood pressure goes high, and breathing becomes haphazard. Your whole body is in a temporary delirium at the lowest. And at the last center, the situation is absolutely, totally different. Your whole body has become so cool, so silent, as if it has disappeared. And when it has disappeared, you feel that you are levitating. You are so happy that you feel that you are not sitting on the ground, instead you are above the ground. You cannot feel it. You have become bodiless. And when you are silent, the whole existence is silence, because the existence is nothing else but a mirror. It reflects or mirrors you. In thousands and thousands of mirrors, it reflects you. When you are silent, the whole existence has become silent. These are the seven centers, and heart center is just in the middle, three centers below and three centers above. The below are water center, the earth center, and the fire center. Those three belong to an extrovert personality. In the West, the majority lives through these three centers. And now, even in the East, the majority is moving towards the Western attitude of life. These three centers are very easily available. They have certain given function, and you need not work much on them. Without them, life will become impossible. They are survival measures. So nature has not given you a choice between them. From the moment you are born, these three centers start functioning. They go on functioning. You do not need to make any effort to feel egoistic. You do not need to make any effort to feel the desires, because it is natural for the desires to arise in you. It is natural for anger to come into you. It is natural to feel egoistic. They are the survival measures. So nature has not given you any choice between them. From the moment you are born, those three centers begin functioning. They go on functioning until you die. The whole life is covered by these three centers. An extrovert person never comes to know that there is anything higher than these. Sex, money, power, prestige, respectability, name, and fame all belong to this category. And the center of all those chakras is sex, is the guiding force. People seek money in order to seek sex. People seek fame and power and prestige in order to seek sex. Sex remains the center of the lower three chakras. Sex remains the center of the extrovert personality. His whole mind revolves around that. And when you begin to move upward, it begins to make a change. Between these two is the heart center. Between the introvert and extrovert is the heart that functions as a door. Heart is the bridge. Just as sex is the center of the extrovert mind, prayer or meditation is the center of the introvert mind. Just as sex is the center of the extrovert mind, prayer or meditation is the center of the introvert mind. But to call it prayer is more relevant. Between these two, when a person is just in the middle on the fourth chakra, at the door love springs forth. Love is between sex and prayer. When sex is somewhat purified, it becomes love. When love is also purified, it becomes prayer. So it is the same energy, the sexual or the existential bioenergy that goes higher. In the East, people have tried to live an introvert life. They have tried to live above the heart, but both are lopsided. The Western extrovert mind and the Eastern introvert mind are both lopsided. To become a total man, one needs the functioning of all the seven centers together. You be in the world, but do not let the world be within you. You go to work as if you are an enlightened one. Nothing bothers you, nothing disturbs you. You go and do your work. Because for living, I must interact, whatever job has been given to me. Sufis has never run away from the active life. If their profession was a shoemaking, they continued to make the shoes. If their profession was something else, they continued in that vocation, and being in that, they have experienced, they have manifested, they have exhibited a different kind of functioning. You are amidst the turmoils, a life which is totally extrovert, and yet still you are not disturbed. Wherever you go, you carry your torchlight of awakening, of your love, of your understanding, and that you share with you. Whosoever comes in your company, at least for a few moments, he forgets the outer world and he starts singing. Whenever I meet someone, those who have heard me on radio, whether they have met me personally or not, as soon as they will meet me, they remember one or the other sentence that I have spoken. One person who met me long time, maybe it would have been 25 years now, anytime he meets me, he only remembers one line. There is nothing higher, there is nothing lower. Higher is the beginning, higher is the culmination of lower, and lower is the beginning of higher. He remembers that, but that is all. So somewhere or the other, you leave an impression on the mind of the person that no matter what circumstance and situation comes, this person is calm under all circumstances and situations. You carry that light within wherever you go. Whosoever comes in your contact cannot remain unaffected by that light. It is not a question of choice. It is a question of being capable of living in all the centers without any conflict. It is none that can create conflict. It is the mind, it is we who create conflict. You have to go beyond that. And that is the way of a spiritual life. That is the way you have to live your life according to all the centers. You are not in the body. You are not the body. You are in the world, but the world is not within you. And that is the way we have to live our life. And that is transcendence.